Okay, this is a video that I'm putting together mostly for information for those who would like to restore the old jeweler's regulator with a French pinwheel movement in it. There's some question about how they came apart. I know I had a heck of a time figuring it out, but this is where we're going with this. The clock in question is this one. It belongs to the Kishwaukee Valley Heritage Society Museum, and it hadn't run since the 1950s. It had been stored in a basement for a couple decades, and as a result, the movement was pretty nasty. I didn't really take many pictures or videos of the process of restoring this until later in the game, until after it was all cleaned. It was pretty messy. There was a lot of verdigris on the pinwheel. Looked like it had a crystal farm going on it, but we're going to take a look at this. This is the pretty much the way the movement looked when I first got it. Doesn't look really too bad. Really had no worn pivots in it. Was pretty much just dirt and damage to the attachments for the minute and hour hands. Here are some pictures of the movement before it was dismantled and cleaned. This is the end of the pendulum assembly, and which is stamped number 51. Just one of a number of parts that were stamped with that number. The pendulum suspension spring block also had stamped on the back of it the word France. This is the end of the escapement arbor and its pivot on which the second's hand goes. And this is one of the pieces of damage that I found to the movement. You can clearly see that the pivot, the extended pivot, is bent, and that had to be straightened. This is a good example of another kind of stupid handling of movements. Whoever messed with this thing last decided they paint the iron box with a flat black paint. They did it with the movement inside. And this is just one of the many pieces that I had to clean black flat paint off of. I just can't believe somebody would do something like that. This is the base of the hour hand, which some professional decided that he should take a prick punch and pound the living daylights out of it to apparently tighten up the square, because they had destroyed the normal mode of attaching the hand, and they tightened the square up and then peened the daylights out of the end of the hour tube to reattach the hand. And this picture shows one of the plates, a back plate I believe, that somebody decided to, I don't know what they were doing. It looks like a woodpecker went to work on it to ding it all up. Heaven knows what they did. And this is one of the doors that's on the side of the iron box the movement is in. It's also stamped with a number 51. The rest of this will be videos basically showing some of the problems with the hand attachment. Also gets into then I disassemble the movement again to show how that was done. Took me a while to figure out how it was done, and then I reassemble it and then show you a view at the end of the clock in running condition down at the museum.
Okay, we're looking at the where the hour and minute hands on this Waterbury jeweler's regulator with the French movement in it, where the how the hands are supposed to go on. The hour hand on this one, the minute hand on this one. The hands are square, supposed to be a square on here for the hand to go on to. And then there's supposed to be some grooves cut, like here and here, for a square washer to go on, be turned a quarter of a turn to lock the hand on. Now the problem is that there's no washers that are with this movement, and so the last repairman, quote repairman, put the hands on by staking the end of the shaft onto the hand, put it on, thus here totally obliterating the groove, destroying it completely. Kind of obscuring that one. Oh, for this one, I think I'll try me remaking a washer to fit and see if the three corners will hold it on. Otherwise, I'm going to have to do some kind of repair on this, restore it to original condition. And for the minute hand, let's see, not much of a groove left there on that corner. Tiny bit of one there. Did the same thing, just kind of staked or peened the thing on, and in this case used the nut to help put it on. The nut that go, what would normally be considered a hand nut, goes on here, actually is the pivot for the extended arbor of the escape wheel that comes through the center of this. Then the nut screws on, and it also acts as an arbor. So they relied on that nut holding the hand on, as well as kind of staking a little bit. But we'll make a couple washers, see how that works out, and if that doesn't work, why, we'll go back and probably going to have to cut some of this shaft off, especially on this one. This has been so butchered up that, see where the stake was put on there and pounded on. May have to cut this back a little bit. Don't like to think about having to remachine the whole thing, which may end up being a case, but be nice to see if we can remake the piece that's been mangled. maybe silver solder it on, reshape everything, recreate the groove for the washer. We'll check it out.
This is the pinwheel French movement out of a Waterbury jeweler's regulator, and I had a heck of a time learning how to take this thing apart, as there are no posts between the front and back plate of the movement itself. There's a lot of question as to how this thing came apart. Well, there's by removing a couple of cocks from the front of the movement. All of these pieces can be removed without taking the plates apart. Once you're at this point, the rest of it requires that the there's four more wheels. There's the main wheel, second wheel, third wheel, and then the escapement itself would have to come out. And some question as to how that comes apart. The plates, what serves as the pillars between the brass plates, is the top and the bottom of the iron case that goes around it. And there are four screws at the top, so that seems evident. If we take those screws out, we ought to be able to get the plates out, if the same thing is true on the bottom. Problem is, when you look at the bottom, what you see is what appears to be either some kind of pins or cut-off screws. In fact, what they are little nubs that are extensions of the brass plates that simply fit down into the holes in the bottom of the iron case. So by removing the top screws on the inside of this movement in the top, there is also a little right there, you see it, a little triangular groove right there. I guess can't get any closer than that. A little triangular groove, and on the top plate is also a triangular extension that fits into that groove. So once you've got those cocks removed and the wheels removed that can be taken out, then the plates can be tipped. The front plate can be tipped forward at the top, and the back plate can be tipped backward at the top and removed from the iron case and the rest of the wheels taken out. And we'll take a look at that. So the next step is to remove these four screws. And then back plate, and they're not loose. They have to be pulled like that. We tip back, and then the front as well can be pulled forward. Well, it's a little tighter, and the wheels simply fall out. And there are those nubs. The nubs on the bottom that fit into the holes in the iron plate. So those nubs again will go back in. There's that little, I don't know if I can see that, a little triangular
extension on the top, very tiny, that fits into a groove into the top of the iron box, and that's how that all comes out. Now the escapement can be removed, as well as the second wheel, and the main wheel can come out. And once those are out, then the front plate can be tipped forward in the same manner and taken out. Okay, to reassemble this, the way I've found it easiest, put the front plate in first. Awkward doing this. Those nubs you can see on the bottom go into the two holes. Then that little V notch, little V extension, lined up with the notch. The front plate can be pushed back into place until you can see the holes in the top plate line up with the top of the iron. And we can take two of those if we want at this point. Put those screws back in. I don't know how long I looked until I found somebody who described it, but they really had no pictures or videos of how that worked. And so I thought I'd at least try to put something together for people in the future who want to take one of these apart. Alright, so then we're going to take our main wheel. You can put it into place, maintaining power out of the way. Okay, with the first wheel in place, or the main wheel, we've got these two that are going to go in here. You got to get this third wheel through, and the second wheel goes here, and this is going to go here, and the escape wheel, pinwheel, a very long arbor that goes through the center here, and the end of the pivot of the escape wheel serves for the attachment point for the second hand. So that goes in there. And I'm going to get that all out of the way. And those are all in place. Those are the four gears that have to be in there, four wheels that have to be in there before we put the back plate on. Anyway, there's the nubs on the bottom of the plate that are going to go in those two holes. And there's the little V on the top that's going to go into that little V notch that's in there. So we're going to set these into place. And now find that V notch. I don't know if you can see that V notch. There's the V, the V notch, and that's going to go in there. Down on those nubs, and this is a snug fit. You gotta get the great wheel going in that hole at the same time into the pivot hole. There we go, and that starts it in. And the other one we have to get in immediately is the second wheel. As we push this in, feel it get tighter. Okay, I think I got it now. Okay, now that we have the back plate into position, it's the main wheel and the second wheel that had to be put into the pivots. And now the third wheel, find its pivot hole, And the escape gear, you'll find its pivot hole. And those are in place. Now the escape can always slide out of there because it's sticking way out here. There's its arbor end. That's also going to be the attachment for the second hand, and also with this nut in place, this will be a pivot hole for this pivot. These whole wheels all have to go on. Okay. Then this cock can go on. Find the pivot hole. These hands are not slip fittings. I mean, the hour hand sets in place as well as the minute hand. So, good thing they're square holes. They have to be lined up to begin with, and they're held on with washers. Show you how those work. They were missing from the movement, as I said before. And I still have to blue all these and everything, so anyway, when the hour hand goes on, it's square. You have to have a little square washer. This is made out of spring, a little bit of spring steel, and all filed by hand to fit onto the hour hand. We're not going to do that now. Hour hand shaft, and then it's rotated about 45 degrees, and that locks the hour hand onto the shaft. Then the minute hand is put on, and another square washer is put on the top of it, and it rotates 45 degrees to hold it on. Whoever messed with this clock before had lost or misunderstood how that all worked. So when they dismantled it, they lost those washers or threw them out. And then when they reassembled the clock, they simply took a stake and they staked the damned hands on. And, of course, that damaged those, so I had to refile a little slots and then make the washers so that they would rotate in there and lock those hands on. And while number 51 was stamped on the iron box and a number of the parts, the only other indication I had of make is in on the backside of the suspension spring block is France stamped on it. So now that has to go here. Little rod that slips in that crutch, and that will be attached there with a couple of screws. Right, this is the nut. It goes on the end of the time, the cannon, and you see it has a hole in it, and what extends through that hole is the pivot for the escape wheel, the end of which is then the second hand is mounted on. Notice there are external threads that thread inside that piece. That serves as the outside pivot hole for the escape wheel, as well as the escape wheel arbor pivot end, then acting as the placement for the seconds hand. And there's the end of the escape wheel arbor sticking through, and it's almost impossible to see, but there are internal threads there that that nut goes on to. See if I can do that. Okay, that threads in there, and that then is the pivot hole for the seconds arbor. This is the seconds hand that I'm stripping the two layers of black paint off of, and I'm going to re-blue this. And that goes on the end, like so, and turns, okay. That's all there is to it. So that nut is essential for both the attachment of the seconds wheel and as the pivot hole for the arbor that extends through from the escape gear. Now all we need to do is attach a pendulum back to that, and it's all back together. So we'll put some oil on the pivot points, and then we're going to take this back down to the museum and reinstall it in a clock. We don't have a pendulum on this, but thought we'd temporarily suspend the weight and just see if it would run without a pendulum, as we're going to take it down to the museum to get the pendulum on. And looks like it's going to run fine. Alright, when I brought this home, it had steel cable on it. It was fraying. Didn't like it. As I understand, the original cable on this is probably gut. So I'm using woven nylon that I stained with tea. Hello, Warren.
Hi there. Have you seen our new, brand new clock? Shiny. Keeps time. At least in the last 30 minutes it has.